Hi everyone, thanks for checking out this video. I am Yogesh and I'll present our work on decision tree rank. This is joint work with Meena Mahajan and we both are affiliated to Institute of Mathematical Sciences, Chennai. So the outline of the talk is as follows. In the first half of the presentation, I'll set up some motivation for our work and tell you what it is all about. And in the second half, I'll tell you about our results and try to sketch some of the proofs. Okay, so let me set up some motivation. So central question in theoretical computer science is to study limitation and powers of various computational models. There are various computational models like Turing machines, formulas and circuits, communication protocols, decision trees, and many more. Given our computational model, there are two types of questions one asks. On the algorithmic side, given a problem, one looks for an efficient way to solve the problem in a given model. And on the negative side, on the lower bound side, one looks for the explicit hard problems for a given model of computation. What efficiency and hardness means depend on the model of computation, and I'll say more on this later. Let me say something about problems. What problems are we talking about? All kind of computational problems. For example, given a graph, check if it contains a large clique or not. Given a set of linear equation, find a common solution. The observation or the point that I'm trying to make is that these problems can be encoded as Boolean functions. Okay, at least for the decision problems where you check a certain property, it is obvious that you can encode them as Boolean functions. For example, if you want to check if a number is prime or not, you can map all the prime numbers to 1 and all the non-prime numbers to 0 and get a Boolean function for your problem. Okay, for search problems where you are looking for a solution, even those problems can be cast as a bunch of decision problems. Let me not go into that. But the bottom line is this. The problems for us will be nothing but certain Boolean functions. So the problems are Boolean functions for us. The model of computation that we will study in our work is this decision tree model of computation. Okay, so let me now define this model of computation. So in decision tree model of computation, one asks a bunch of queries in an adaptive manner. That is, depending on the answers to your current queries, you frame your future queries. And once you have the enough information, you output the answer. Okay, so let's take an example. Let's say you want to check if a number is prime or not. Okay, so you can start by asking if the last digit is 0 or not. Okay. If it's 0, then you know the number is composite. If it's not 0, you can ask further queries. Okay. For example, you can ask if the last digit is 2 or 5. If it's true, and if you further know the number of digits in your number, then you can decide if the number is prime or composite. And you can go on like this. Okay. The idea is this, that depending on the answers to your queries, you frame your future queries and you accumulate information. And once you have the enough information, you output your answer. Okay. So let me say this, that there are some restrictions to kind of queries that you can ask. And depending on the type of queries that you ask, you have various decision trees for each type of queries. The type of decision tree that we will study will be simple decision trees. What I mean by simple is that the queries will be just variable queries. Okay, so let me take an example of AND function, AND on n bits. That is, that it is 1 if and only if all the bits are set to 1. Okay, so this is the decision tree for AND function. You query all the variables, and if at any point you find a variable which is set to 0, you output a 0, otherwise you output a 1. We call it a simple decision tree because our queries are just variable queries. Okay. There can be other decision trees as well. For example, there are parity decision trees where queries are parity of subset of variables. There are linear decision trees where your queries are linear inequalities. Okay, but in our work, we will focus on simple decision trees. Okay. Formally, simple decision tree is nothing but a binary tree where nodes are labeled by variables, leaves are labeled by 0 and 1. And for evaluation, you traverse down the tree starting from the root, querying variables on nodes. If the queried variable evaluates to 0, you go left. If the queried variable evaluates to 1, you go right. And finally, you return the label on leaf that you have reached. Okay. So on the input on the slide, this is the path that your input will trace on the decision tree. Okay. So as for us, the model of computation of interest will be this decision tree model of computation. Now, once we have the model of computation, we would like to measure the complexity of a problem in that model of computation. So how does one measure the complexity of problem in decision trees? So there are these two common complexity measures that are used. One is depth and the other is size. Depth for a decision tree is the length of the longest root to leaf path. And the size is just the number of leaves. For example, there are these two decision trees on the slide. On the left, we have a decision tree for parity. On the right, we have a decision tree for AND function. And you can see that the depth of parity is N and size of parity is 2 to the N. And for AND function, depth is N and size is just N plus 1. Okay. For a function F, depth for a function F is defined as the minimum depth of a decision tree computing F. And you can define the size similarly. You choose an optimal tree computing F with the minimum parameter of interest. Okay. So we saw two complexity measure which are commonly used to measure the complexity of a problem in decision tree. But there are also other measures which are independent of model of computation. And these are intrinsic measures, which quantifies the hardness of a function in some way. Okay. And I'll give you some examples of intrinsic measures in a minute. But an interesting question that people study is to relate the complexity measure with intrinsic measures. Because that way, you will get to know how powerful your model of computation is, or how limited your model of computation is. And you will also be able to compare various model of computation through these relations. Okay. So let me give you some example of intrinsic measures. One is this sensitivity of a function. Okay. So let me not define it formally, but what it quantifies is like how sensitive is your function to change of input. Okay. And there are various notions of sensitivity, block sensitivity, average sensitivity, and many more. Let me not go into those. Let me go into this other intrinsic measure, which is certificate complexity of a function. So this is the measure that will be of interest to us. So let me define this measure. An F certificate for input A is a set S which is subset of 1 to the N, such that the value of FA can be determined by just looking at the bits of A in S. Okay, so if you just look at the bits of your input in S, you're able to determine the value of FA. Such an S will be a certificate for your input A. Okay. And so the certificate complexity of F at input A will be nothing but the minimum size certificate for your input A. And certificate complexity of the function F will be you know, the size of the maximum certificate, like largest certificate. And if you restrict your inputs to zero inputs, then you get a zero certificate complexity. Similarly, you get a one certificate complexity. And there is this also minimum certificate complexity, which is the size of the minimum certificate, the smallest certificate. Okay. So let me give you an example to make things more concrete. Let's consider this example of AND composed with OR. Okay, I'll call this function tribes in my presentation. It's actually a dual of the tribes function, because in literature, tribes is usually OR composed with AND. But for my presentation, I'll call AND composed with OR as the tribes function. So you can see tribes as a function on M cross N matrix of variables. Okay. And it's one if and only if each row has a variable set to one. Okay. So let's observe what the zero certificate complexity, one certificate complexity, and certificate complexity for tribes is. Okay. Observe that for tribes, the zero certificate complexity is N. Because to certify any zero input, one would have to reveal a row of variables, all of which are set to zero, right? So that's why the zero certificate complexity is equal to N. The one certificate complexity for tribes is M. Because to certify any one input, one would have to reveal the identity of a variable per row, which is set to one. Okay, so that's why the one certificate complexity of tribes is equal to M. And okay, so M is the arity of AND and N is the arity of OR. Okay. So the certificate complexity for tribes is this max of M and N. Okay. So what we talked about was these intrinsic measures. We saw sensitivity and certificate complexity. There are others as well. Like block sensitivity, degree, approximate degree, and many more. But as I said, an interesting question is to relate complexity measures with intrinsic measures. For example, in case of depth, we know that depth is polynomially related to many of these intrinsic measures. Okay. Okay, so now let me come to another complexity measure, which is rank of a Boolean function. So this is the measure that is the focus, that is focus of our study, that is focus of our paper. We are studying the rank measure for a Boolean function, and it's a complexity measure. Okay, let me define the rank measure. For a binary tree T, the rank is defined recursively. For leaf nodes, we assign the rank 0. For internal node U with children V and W, the rank of U is equal to rank of V plus 1 if the rank of both the child node is same. And the rank of U is max of rank of both the child nodes if the rank of both the child nodes is different. So if the rank increases by 1, if the rank of both the child nodes is same, and rank is max of the child node if the rank of the child nodes is different. The rank of the binary tree is the rank of the root node. Okay. See, on the right, I have this tree, and I've labeled the nodes with their rank values. So the rank of this tree is 2. Okay. Rank of a Boolean function is, as you can guess, it's a minimal rank of a decision tree computing F. Okay. Let me give you some intuition on rank. Okay. So on the slide, you can see this tree. I have labeled the nodes of this tree with the rank value. And now do the following thing. Okay. Start from the root. If both the children have the same rank, branch out to both of them. Otherwise, move to the child which has larger rank. Okay. Branching is denoted by red color, and moving to child with larger rank is illustrated by blue color in the figure. Now, if you shrink the blue edges, what you get is a complete binary tree of depth equal to rank. Right? So a tree with rank R has a complete binary tree of depth R embedded in it. Okay. So what this tells us is that a large rank implies a large size. So if a rank of a tree is R, then that means that that a complete binary tree of depth R is embeddable in that tree. Okay. That's the intuition for rank. Okay. So why is this complexity measure rank interesting? Why study rank? Why is it interesting? Right. So let me try to convince you. One, it shows up in various places, various different places. For example, in learning theory, Ehrenfest and Hosler showed that constant rank decision trees are efficiently learnable in this popular back learning framework. In circuit complexity shows up, it comes up in proof complexity as well. And I'll say more on this later. So it shows up in various places. The other reason is that it reveals additional information not revealed by other complexity measures. For example, if you consider parity function and AND function, you know that depth of parity and AND both have depth equal to N. But in many ways, we know that parity is much more complex function than the AND function. But depth is not able to distinguish that difference. On the other hand, rank can make that distinction, because the rank of parity is N and rank of AND function is 1. Okay, so rank is revealing additional information not captured by other complexity measures. The other reason is that it characterizes log of size up to multiplicative log N factor. Okay. So there are many interesting reasons to study rank. And that's what we do in our work. Let me now mention our contribution, our main contributions. The first thing that we do is we relate rank to the value of prover delayer game of Pudluck and Impaglia. So, played on function f. This thing is implicit in earlier work, but we make this connection explicit, and this gives us a way to prove rank upper bound and lower bound using these prover delayer games. Okay. Second, we relate rank to certificate complexity. So rank, as I said, is a complexity measure, and the certificate complexity is an intrinsic measure, and we try to study the relation. Okay. Third, we study rank of composed function and relate its rank to the rank of the inner function and the depth of the outer function. Precisely, this is the relation that we get. We're able to say something about the rank of the composed function in terms of depth of the outer function and the rank of the inner function. And by computing the explicit rank of various functions, we show that all our bounds that we have obtained in our work are tight. Okay. Now I'll tell you more about our results. Let me tell you something about each of them. And let me start by telling you about the relation of rank to this prove or delare game of Pudlak and Impaclius. So the game is played on the function f, okay, and there are two players, prover and delayer. They construct a partial assignment row in rounds. In each round, prover queries a variable xi, not set by the partial assignment row. Delayer responds either by a bit value 0 or 1 for xi, or it defers the choice to prover. In which case, the prover chooses a value for xi and delayer gets a point. Okay, so the delayer can defer the choice to the prover, and then the prover will have the choice to choose a value for xi. And when delayer defers, delayer will get a point. Okay. And game ends when the value of f is known from the partial assignment. The number of points scored by the delayer in the game is the value of the game. Okay. And the value of the function is the maximum k, such that delayer can always score k points. Okay. So the value is something you get out of this prove or delayer game. And what one can show is that this value of this prove or delayer game for a function f is exactly equal to rank. So this value from the prove or delayer game captures the rank exactly. Okay. So the upper bound is proved by exhibiting a prover strategy which restrict delayer to at most rank of f many points. And the lower bound is proved by exhibiting a delayer strategy which always scores a rank of f many points irrespective of prover strategy. That's how you prove this claim. Okay. And once the above claim is established, one gets a way to prove rank upper bounds and lower bounds, right? Exhibiting a prover strategy restricting delayers to R points gives an upper bound of R on rank of F, right? And exhibiting a delayer strategy which always score R points irrespective of prover strategy gives a lower bound of R on rank of F. Okay. So this connection of rank with this prover delayer game gives us a way to calculate rank for various functions. Okay. So let me also mention this, that there is also an asymmetric prover delayer game which exactly characterizes log of size of a function. Okay. Next, we establish the relation of rank with certificate complexity. Right. For depth, we know that depth is lower bounded by certificate complexity and upper bounded by product of zero certificate complexity and one certificate complexity. And both these bounds are ticked. Lower bound is witnessed by the OR function and the upper bound is witnessed by the TRIBES function. The natural question is, how is rank related to certificate complexity? Can we say something about rank and certificate complexity of F? And this is what we get in terms of an upper bound. Rank of F can be upper bounded by zero certificate complexity minus one into one certificate complexity minus one plus one. Okay. And the proof idea is as follows. We give a construction, and this construction is an adaptation of the construction for depth. And the construction is as follows. One starts by querying all the variable in a zero certificate. And now observe that any zero certificate and any one certificate must always intersect. Right? So what this tells us is that after querying a zero certificate, the one certificate complexity of the restricted function will go down by one. Okay. Now do this. Keep querying zero certificates until one certificate complexity of the restricted function becomes one. And when the one certificate complexity is one, you construct a rank one decision tree by querying all the one certificates one by one. This is our construction. And analyzing the rank of this construction will give us the desired upper bound. And the idea is this, the rank of all these cascaded parts in your construction, where you're querying these zero certificates, will just add up and will give you what you want. Okay. The natural next question is, what can we say in terms of lower bound? Right. We know for depth, certificate complexity is the lower bound. Can we say something similar in case of rank? It turns out a lot of the candidates for lower bounds actually fail to be a lower bound. Certificate complexity, min of zero certificate complexity and one certificate complexity, average certificate complexity, all these are not lower bound on the rank. And we have these counter examples, which tells us that these cannot be lower bound on rank. What one can show in terms of lower bound is that this minimum certificate complexity is the lower bound on the rank. And this comes simply by observing that if you take a rank optimal tree T for F, then each root to leaf path forms a zero or a one certificate. Right? In any tree, in any decision tree for a function, each root to leaf path forms either a zero certificate or a one certificate. And since the minimum certificate complexity is C min of F, we have that the depth of each leaf is at least C min of F, right? And so a full binary tree of depth C min of F is embeddable inside your decision tree, inside your optimal decision tree. And that the rank of your function is at least C min of F, right? Let me make this observation. A lot of the examples that we have seen so far, it turns out that none of them counter certificate complexity being an upper bound. Okay. So the question is, can CF be an upper bound? Can the certificate complexity be an upper bound on rank? Okay. And we show that this is not possible. There is this counter example of majority dot maturity, which makes it impossible for CF being an upper bound because CF is less than rank for majority dot maturity. What we can show is that for symmetric function, CF is the upper bound. Okay, for symmetric function, we get a different upper bound. For symmetric function, we can say that certificate complexity is upper bound, but in general we can't say this. So let me skip the proof idea. So we related certificate complexity to rank. We got an upper bound, and we have some lower bound, and we argued that a lot of common candidates cannot be lower bounds on certificate complexity. Next, we study rank of composed function. Okay. For depth, depth behaves very nicely under composition because we know that depth of F composed with G is exactly equal to depth of F into depth of G. So our motivation was, can we say something similar for rank? Okay, can we bound rank of F composed with G as a function of rank of F and rank of G? And our first claim is this, that the rank of composed function cannot be bounded by any function of rank of f and rank of g alone. And this is established using Tribbs function. We show that the rank of Tribbs function is equal to n, and we know that the rank of AND function and OR function is 1. So the rank of the outer function and the rank of the inner function are both 1, and rank of your composed function is n. So no function of rank of f and rank of g can upper bound the rank of the composed function. Okay. So what can one say in terms of upper bound? What can we get in terms of upper bound? What we can show is following. Rank of f composed with g can be upper bounded by depth of f and rank of g, depth of the outer function and the rank of the inner function. And the construction is a very obvious construction. Let me say first this, that this bound is tight, and it is observed and it is witnessed by the Tribbs function. And okay, so let me give you the construction. The construction is very obvious construction. You start with a depth optimal tree for f, and each of the internal node, you inflate them with rank optimal trees for g on appropriate variables. And the decision tree that you get out of this construction, if you analyze the rank of this construction, you'll get the upper bound. Okay, it's a natural way to construct the decision tree for the composed function. Okay, the interesting part is to come up with a lower bound in terms of rank of f and in terms of depth of f and rank of g. And we show that rank of f composed with g is at least depth of f into rank of g minus 1 plus 1. And this again is tight and is witnessed by AND composed with parity function. Okay. And how do we prove this? Actually, we prove much more general statement where the composed function can be different. Okay. And we use this notion of weighted depth complexity. Let me not define these things. But the idea is this. Once the right generalization is set, the proof is careful induction and lengthy and tedious case analysis. So it can be established. So this result can be established. So what we have is that the rank of the composed function can be related to depth of the outer function and the rank of the inner function. Okay. So let me conclude. What we study in our work is this complexity measure, which is rank. Rank is an interesting measure. It's what we feel, because it shows up in various places. Moreover, it reveals additional information not revealed by other complexity measures, right? That's the reason we studied rank. And we think that it will be interesting to find more application of rank in future work. So yeah, so I'll stop there. Thanks for checking out our work. Thanks.